Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the Dole Institute. I'm Bill Lacey, the director. If you're wondering why I'm standing here and Judge Ford isn't standing here, her flight changed on her today. They had, Judge Sherrod and I were talking, they had, I think you said, 5 inches of snow up in Boston. So in mid-April, or, well, it's just the 5th of April, but that's a little late for my taste. But anyway, she had to deal with that. So she should be here very shortly. I thought that it would be great, and the judge has agreed, if I could just introduce her to you, and you could get to know her a little bit before Judge Ford gets here, and then when Judge Ford gets here, we'll just kind of have her come on up and take over the interview. Judge Sherrod and I just got a chance to meet and talk, and we're actually from the same part of the country. She's from Huntsville, Alabama. Are you from there, or you just live there now?
I'm originally from Gadsden, Alabama. You can tell I'm a big city girl.
Gadsden, is that in South
That's
Alabama?
That's in East Alabama.
East Alabama.
It's less than an hour from Atlanta, Georgia.
Okay.
Which is the city if you're from Gadsden, Alabama.
Yeah, and the judge went to school about 80 miles from where I was raised, and in the same town where I went to Vanderbilt. She went to Fisk University, which is a very well-known university, and we're delighted to have her here. I got to have a great discussion. I'm just going to turn it over to you and let you tell a little bit about your life and your career.
I will indeed.
Great. Please welcome Judge Sherrod.
Thank you. A special thanks to Director Lacey and to the Institute for allowing me, a girl from Alabama, to be here to have this discussion with you. I'm extremely delighted. What an impressive facility you have here. This is top notch. But more importantly, I'm equally as impressed by the mission of the Institute, the bipartisan focus, as well as trying to get even young people engaged in the political process, which, other than doing presidential election years, is quite a task. But I was born in Alabama. I anticipate that I'll be buried in Alabama. My husband and my mother used to argue over whether it was going to be in Gadsden or Huntsville. I stayed out of the argument because it really won't matter much to me at that time. Being a native Alabamian, I'm a graduate of the public school system, a product of, went to Fisk University in Nashville, Tennessee. Actually had an opportunity to take some courses at Vanderbilt. Fisk University is a very small school in Nashville. It is a religious school. But at that time, I thought I wanted to be a psychologist. And being a psychologist required that you have some statistical background. And I actually took two statistics courses on the campus of Vanderbilt. And it was, let me say, I don't have fond memories of those statistic courses at Vanderbilt. This was during the late 60s, early 70s. That was at a period of time when there was a lot of turmoil in America. So I can remember, and by the way, we didn't have cars. You guys have cars. There were 18 blocks between Fisk and Vanderbilt. How do I know? Because I walked them and I counted them. Now that was before they actually put the interstate in that separated the two campuses, but we were able to walk. And if you didn't walk, you took the bus. You took the bus and you rode, and the bus fare was 25 cents. Now let me say to you, I've got to share a quick story with you. I spoke at an elementary school. It's actually Martin Luther King Elementary School, and I spoke to a group of third graders, and I told them that when I was a child growing up and when I started to date, mother did not let me leave home without a quarter. See, these folks on this side know what I'm talking about. And then they said, well, what was the quarter for? I said, so you could call home if something happened. And mother said, call me anytime, day or night, and I will be there to get you, but you gotta have a quarter when you leave home. And the kid said, well, what do you do with the quarter? I said, you put it in your telephone booth. And they said, what? How do you get a quarter in your cell phone? I said, they had zero concept of what I was talking about because we're raising a generation of cell phone users that did not understand that there were telephones in public places along the highway, along the street, and you stopped and you put money in and you could call wherever you wanted to. And I started to describe for them what a telephone booth looked like. And I said, now you know how Superman goes into a booth and it's like a square and he comes out and he becomes Superman. And one little girl said, and what do you become when you go in? Well, then I had to change my tactic and sort of explain to them that no, you didn't change, you just went in and you put the money in a little box, you picked up a receiver, you held it to your ear, and you could actually talk to people wherever you wanted to talk. If it was long distance, you had to put more money in, and it could even give you change. And one little girl on the front row said, Judge, how old are you? So what I'm saying to you, young folks, is I am so pleased to see you here. I'm pleased to see you. I've been in the political processes for a lot of years. I often tell people that I'm not the politician in my family. My husband and my daughters are the politician. My baby went to Washington at age 16 to be a congressional page. Now, her older sister was there, so we weren't sending her alone. And she subsequently, after finishing college, she came back and went to school in Tennessee, went to Tennessee State, and then she went back to Washington to be an intern. Her father was quite concerned about that. That was during the Monica era, and he was real concerned, but she went through and eventually went to work for Congress. Our oldest daughter, who worked for the Congressional Black Caucus, eventually went to work for the Texas delegation, and within the last 2 years, left and went to work for Tenet Healthcare. But my family has been very politically oriented, everybody but me. And I'm the only one that ever ran for office. And I ran for office because it was the only method of becoming a state court judge. In Alabama, we have partisan judicial elections. We're one of only 8 states that continue to have partisan judicial elections. Most states have gone to some hybrid of either a retention program or some other method of selecting their judges. Now, all of them have strong political overtones, because even if you've got to get the governor to select you, you've got to get to the governor and you've got to get to his public policy people that you can get selected. But in Alabama, we have partisan elections for all state court judges. As a result of having partisan elections, and I live in, let me give you a little background on my community. I'm in North Alabama, it's in Madison County, extremely beautiful community. We're known for having the Space and Rocket Center, you've heard of that. TVA is only a hop, skip, and jump for us, so Browns Ferry Nuclear Plant is in that area. Redstone Arsenal is our largest employer. In fact, the feds are the largest single employer in that community. My community is 66% Republican, 25% Democrat, and the rest of them are something else, independents or whatever. So it's also a community where blacks represent only 24.9% of the population. I ran as a Democrat, and I was elected. It required an awful lot of hard work, an awful lot of getting out and engaging people one-on-one. I wore out several pair of shoes. Fortunately, I had a family that was willing to walk the streets and knock on doors and put out signs, and we got so good, we could make 6 church services in one weekend. And everybody keeps saying, how could you do that? How could you do that? Well, also in my community is a large Adventist community, and they have Saturday church. So I could go to church on Friday night. I could go twice, sometimes 3 times on Saturday, and I could go 2-3 times on Sunday. And so why? Because when you're running for office, you go where the people are. Alabama is part of the Bible Belt, and people go to church. And so you have to find the people where they are and have an opportunity to engage them. I did not set out to be a politician. In fact, I often tell people that when I graduated from high school, I don't think I knew a lawyer. I don't think I could get a lawyer by name. Eventually, my mother went to work for a lawyer, and that lawyer encouraged me to go to law school. And when you apply for law school, you need three lawyers to give you references. Well, when you apply for the bar in Alabama, you need three lawyers to give you references. I didn't know three lawyers. I had to get to know three lawyers. I knew only one lawyer who introduced me to two others. And I decided that that's exactly what I wanted to do. I started law school at the University of Houston. I was married, and my husband was a coach. He coached football at the time. At some point, he coached golf also. But we lived in Beaumont, Texas, and I went to the University of Houston. I was there exactly 8 days before I found out I was pregnant with my Laura. And the only person in Houston whose phone number I knew was his ex-wife, so I called her right away. She hung up, but we eventually were able to forge a relationship. So I went through my first year of law school pregnant, and I had an automobile accident in December, and Ed drove me from Houston, Texas to Gadsden, Alabama, so my mother could care for me. And in January, he drove me back to Houston so I could take my first semester finals. In March, I delivered Laura by cesarean. I was on my way to constitutional law and went into labor and thought I could stop by the hospital and find out what was going on. It didn't quite work out that way. So she was born weighing 8 pounds. And I was in the hospital for 5 days, having had a cesarean. Upon release, I had to go back to class. The University of Houston felt so sorry for me that they gave me a room on the campus, but the only available room was in an athletic dormitory. But the guys were great because they would come out and help me get the baby. At that time, I had a luggage carrier. Now, you folks have luggage that roll, and I do too. Well, back then, you know, you had to strap it onto a device in order to get it to roll. Well, that's how I carried my books, because law school, we had books. I didn't have a laptop. I didn't have a computer. So I had to carry these huge books everywhere, and I'd put them on a luggage carrier, and I could put her in her carrier and put her on my back, and we could go across the campus. But there was this really nice, big, ugly basketball player that came out every day to help me. And of course, at the time, I'm trying to go to law school. I don't know anything about. And he spoke with an accent, so I didn't understand everything he said. But he could hold my baby with his hand because his hand was so big. His name was Akeem Olajuwon. And he was such a nice guy. Well, my husband actually got a job back in Alabama. We were so excited. We returned to Alabama for my last year of law school. So it's like starting all back over again. And now I'm at the University of Alabama in Tuscaloosa in law school, and I live in Huntsville, which is 1 hour and 34 minutes from my house to the campus. From my house to Birmingham was 1 hour and 34 minutes. And how do I know that? Because I had to stop in Birmingham to change her diaper as we were going back and forth. I tell people often that it embarrasses her to no end that she was potty trained somewhere along I-59. And you know how it is when you first start potty training them every few minutes. I need to use the potty. If you don't stop, I'm gonna wet my new pants. So, you know, you stop and you go back and forth. But ultimately, I was successful and was able to finish law school. It has been a wonderful career. It was certainly the right choice for me. I think that being a lawyer allowed me to use all those skills that I'd wanted to use, including helping people. I consider the law a service to the community. I consider it a service that I'm very glad that I've had an opportunity to engage in. I was in the private practice of law for 3 years. I then went to work for our assistant district attorney, who ultimately went on to Congress and became our 5th congressional district congressman, Bud Kramer, and became a judge in 1999. I was appointed by the governor and had to run for a full term in the year 2000, and I was quite successful. It was a grueling race. I was re-elected in 2006 unopposed. I retired from the bench in 2013 to care for my mother. My mother was quite ill at the time. She passed away last July. So now I have decided to re-enter the world of the gainful employed, and I have joined the law firm of counsel there in my community, and my plan is to do mediation. My husband keeps saying, "How hard are you going to work?" I said, "You can't tell. We got to wait and see. It's been a long time since I had a grueling schedule." I believe in mediation. I introduced mediation in small claims court in my community because I truly believe that when litigants are given an opportunity to forge their own remedies, they can. Now, I often would tell them, "Now look, if you can't settle this matter, you're going to get a decision, because the court can make a decision. But if the court makes a decision, there will be a winner and there will be a loser. Now, if you're willing to give some and you're willing to take some and vice versa, then you can forge a remedy that both of you, both sides of the litigation, can come out with something." Several years ago, actually it was back in 2005, when I was chair of the Judicial Council, that's something that Judge Joyce and I have in common. We both served as chair of the Judicial Council of the National Bar Association. And one of the things that I did during my bar year was talk about alternative remedies, because litigation can be quite grueling. And not only that, let me share something with you. In my community, all of the judges are working at least 200% of capacity. We have the largest caseloads in the state. They have the largest caseloads in the state because when we developed the unified judicial system, the number of judges assigned to each judicial district was based on population. Sort of like what happened in New Orleans. Well, since that original assignment, my community has exploded and become the fastest growing community in the state. We're real proud of our community. Not only do we have the fastest growing population, we have one of the highest per capita incomes in the Southeast. We have a community where more than 50% of the people have at least a high school diploma, and an awful lot of them attend one or more of the various colleges and universities around there. So we're very proud of it. But years ago, when they decided how many judges each community could have, we didn't have the population. Well, now we're the third largest community in the state, behind only Jefferson County, which is Birmingham, and Mobile, which is down there on the Gulf with the bay and the white sands and the ships coming in, and you know, really beautiful down there. Wonderful seafood, wonderful seafood. But we're now third in population. At one point, we were considerably down. So that has made a difference. So that's why the judges have the highest caseload. And the other communities don't want to give up any. For 2 years, the Jefferson County judges, the Birmingham judges, came to Huntsville to help us manage our caseload and to actually hear cases. So they've worked at extreme, and we all did. And in fact, at one point, I actually had the largest caseload in the state. Now that was grueling. and it required an awful lot. As a state court judge, and we have courts of general jurisdiction in Alabama, I did civil, I did criminal, and juvenile court. I enjoyed all of it. Let me say my criminals were the ones I liked the most because they were always polite. They came in trying to impress the judge. It was always yes ma'am, no ma'am, and whatever you said. But last December I went back to court to fill in for a judge having surgery. And let me say that I now know why I really didn't like domestic work. They were getting a divorce. And there was just no talking them out of it. He hated her, she hated him. The child was in the middle of all of it. And I kept saying, didn't y'all once love each other? But domestic work brings it, you know, it's ripe for mediation, let me put it like that. But I think very shortly now, Judge Joyce is going, she made it.
Please excuse my appearance.
And let me say, I have seen her an awful lot, and I've never seen her like this.
How is everybody today?
Good, good. Continue.
In fact, I told them earlier, I spoke with you, and when I saw the 5 inches of snow in Boston, it got my attention. But I need to share this with you. Judge Ford now has dual citizenship. She is a citizen of the great state of Alabama. The number one state in the union. Why y'all laughing? Alphabetically, it is number one. That's maybe our only claim.
Your governor's getting you a good publicity right now.
Well, he's getting us publicity. Let's not say it's good, but let's say he's getting us a lot of publicity. The judge here is married to Mayor Johnny Ford. Mayor Ford is the mayor of Tuskegee. Tuskegee is best known as the home of George Washington Carver and Booker T. Washington. The university there has generated more black engineers than any other school in America. They also have a school of veterinary medicine that they hang their hat on, but it's a community that he has now led for
31 years.
31 years. Judge Joyce.
Well, I'm pleased to be here, and I apologize again for being so late. It wasn't the snow. There's no snow down here. But traffic issues, etc., just killed me. But Lynn, I was wondering, did you talk about yourself?
I did.
Okay.
I do that well.
Mm-hmm. You see, we judges have a good time.
and I did. I've given them a little something about my background, mm-hmm. and I've told them a little something about Alabama. Mm-hmm. I venture to the guess that there may be only a couple of people in here that's even been to Alabama. Alabama is not a foreign country. Regardless of what you may have heard, it has full rights as a state in the Union, and it's very much like Kansas. Agriculture is at the height of what's going on there, just as agriculture is big here. Now, you folks have cows, we have chickens, but it is a lot of agriculture going on there.
Well, I think you have a very interesting background. The judge used to be, at one point, the chair of the Judicial Council of the National Bar Association. It's like we were all friends and we all decided we wanted to run things. And so you came after me, right?
I did.
Yeah, and then Alice Bonham.
I was there in 2005.
Right. Right.
It was a good opportunity. Mm-hmm. It's an international organization, and we were able to plan our own meetings. Mm-hmm. So for my winter meeting the year before, they had a meeting in Chicago, and I knew I didn't want to go to Chicago again. And since I could select, we went to Barbados.
And that was in January, right?
That was in January. Mm-hmm. We had January meeting mm-hmm. in Barbados.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was nice. It was very fulfilling. Did you tell people how you became a judge? What incentives?
Well, it's really difficult to describe. I told you when I told them very early on, mm-hmm. when I finished college, I don't think I knew a lawyer. When I got ready to take the bar, I only knew one. And that one had to introduce me to two more because we needed three signatures in order to sit for the Alabama bar. Mm-hmm. I once had a very old judge that I talked to. He's still running around the courthouse doing things, Judge Bill Page. But he used to always say to me, "Sherrod, it's a good job. It's inside work and no heavy lifting." And I said, "Okay, that's pretty good." Most lawyers ascribe for one of two things. One is to be a trial lawyer and make a lot of money, or they want to go into the judiciary. The judiciary, and I personally subscribe to the independence of the judiciary. I do not believe that the judiciary should be influenced by public policy or special interest groups. I believe the judiciary's role is to interpret the law. We don't make the law. Your legislators that you elect and send off to Congress make the law. And I look to the executive branch to enforce those laws. But I believe that our role as judges is to interpret those laws. Now, you know, like I do, sometimes you can look at things and see them in different ways. I keep looking at that dress that folks keep saying, and I keep saying it's blue. So you can see things differently. But I did not start out wanting to even be a lawyer. I told you, I wanted to be a psychologist. I wanted to work with children. I wanted to help people. Just did not work out.
You said public policy. You sort of kept that out. I could see that, and I want you to sort of illuminate some more about that, because when I decided I would become a judge, public policy and politics played a big role. And I think there's a little difference between federal and state, mm-hmm. Because you can't move, you're not supposed to move in the federal system. And I don't know if you had that experience.
Well, not only is there a big difference between the state courts and the federal courts, Judge Joyce was in the federal courts, I've always been a state court judge, but there's a big difference from being in Boston, Massachusetts, and being in Alabama. I became the first person of African descent to win an at-large election in North Alabama. And that was in 2000. That was in, you know, that was not so terribly long ago. And then did it a second time in 2006. And it had not happened before in that community. So where public policy in a Boston may say that we want the judiciary to reflect the community, community norms in Alabama are quite different. Where they may look at racial composition as being part of the community norms in some communities, in my community, you need to be going to somebody's church to do something because it is the Bible Belt. Politics play a big role. It is partisan elections in Alabama, and partisan politics control. It controls in my community. Since I left the courthouse there are no state court judges that identified themselves as Democrats.
That's interesting. And different.
Yeah.
Very different. But you mentioned public policy and you mentioned politics. You had to run for that office.
Yes, I did.
Once you could you talk about that a little bit?
I did. I had to run for office. In fact, I tell everybody, the political in my family is my husband and my daughter. They are the politicians. I was trying to get to a certain point. You had to get there to do it. Fortunately, I had them to show me the ropes because they knew more about grassroots politicking than I did. And they developed a campaign for me. The only thing I brought to the table independently was I knew that when you're out politicking, every time you pass a bathroom, you need to use it because you don't know when you're going to see another one. But they brought to the forefront a campaign where we knocked on doors, where we went to businesses, where we actually raised money to have, and today you got to have radio, TV, all those other things, tags to hang on the doors when nobody's home. Now, some of the things they did, for example, my husband had this bright idea that we needed to get a golf cart so he could drive me from door to door. Let me say that I think I got in that cart once. Otherwise, it's been out at the golf course. So some of the strategies they had, you know, I think they had ulterior motives behind it. But it was extremely important that I appeal to a broad segment of the community. Had to. Blacks only made up 24.9% of my community. And of that 24.9%, the turnout would be only about 18% of the registered voters, which is not unusual. I look at some of the statistics these days and I go, how could anybody in Ferguson, Missouri not go vote? Well, they still don't go vote. They didn't vote before, and they still don't go vote. But that happens. So we developed a strategy that involved the university communities. Alabama A&M is there. Alabama A&M has about 6,000 students. The University of Alabama in Huntsville has about 9,000 students. Oakwood University, which is a Seventh-day Adventist institution, has about 3,000 students. There are community colleges around. So we learned very early on that if we could harness the university communities, that it would work. Very much like what Bernie Sanders is doing right now. And you have to appeal to that community. And we did a lot of things. For example, I employed the Alabama A&M basketball team to drive the people to the polls. All the girls followed the basketball team, and they went and voted. We had dorm captains that knocked on the doors to remind folks, you need to get up and go vote. It's your civic duty. We had lecture series where we went to various groups to talk with them about the significance of their vote and why it was so important. My husband, who is an educator, we started at his school, his high school. High schools have lots of 18-year-olds. And if you register them, most of them vote at the school. We have the neighborhood school concept. So you went to the school in your neighborhood. Voting polling places were at the schools. So they really didn't have to go very far. It was a matter of getting them registered and getting them interested in actually casting a vote. And we developed a series of people. I had a young man named Jordan who was my captain at Lee High School. And he was a very aggressive young man. And he developed songs, and he would sing, and he would dance. And on election day, he went to every junior and senior class to remind students to go vote. And that's what we had to do to make a difference. We impressed upon the students at Alabama A&M, and by the way, let me say that they have not gone out in record numbers like that again, that they could make a difference, that they could choose the mayor. If you have 3,000 registered voters, you're a block. And the mayor's gonna come and say, what do y'all need? I really need your vote. do I need to repave the streets leading up to the university? And those kinds of things will happen. It will make a tremendous difference. Yes, we went to football games. We had campaign rallies at halftime, gave out hot dogs, free hot dogs. And the rapper said, please vote Sherrod.
That's really interesting. So you a long time ago decided you wanted to be a judge.
I decided it.
In 2000?
Well, no, it was around the late 1990s. Mm-hmm. And I didn't just become a state court judge. I first became a municipal court judge. And I was in municipal court for 2 years before my presiding municipal court judge. He didn't get the message that you don't call the young ladies that work in the office. And he did, and he got fired. And I took over as the presiding municipal court judge. And prior to my going there, it was sort of like an armed camp. So first I disarmed everybody, sent them through metal detectors, and you couldn't come in without, if you were armed. And the mayor was so pleased with that, she gave me a raise. But I went from there to the state court.
Like an interesting career. I'm always curious, how were your colleagues?
My colleagues were wonderful. Mm-hmm. And let me say to you that I have never, and you gotta keep in mind, you never know all that your colleagues do and say about you, I recognize that. But from outward appearances, we got along quite well.
Now, why do you say the outward?
Because, you know, they're judges. They're important people. They're going to smile and say the right things in public. My biggest dilemma was in the courtroom. Some of the general public that would come through, they could be less than cordial. I had one young man that, and I also started drug court in my community. I started the first family drug court in the state of Alabama. And I started drug court for criminal offenders in Madison County. So there were a lot of people on drugs that I got to interact with on a daily basis. But and because another one of my theories is that you can't legislate morality. Drug addiction is an illness. It's sort of like diabetes. You know, a lot of type 2 diabetics are that way because they're too fat. They eat the wrong thing. They don't exercise. I heard someone say on the TV recently that we're raising a generation that will live, that will not live as long as their parents, and the quality of their health will be diminished because they're obese. Now, we don't lock people up because they get diabetes from lifestyle. The same thing from drug abuse. I think drug abuse is an illness. It should be treated, that we can't continue to warehouse people, that we absolutely have to have another approach. So we developed drug court, but I would get folks to come through. I had a young man to come into court, and he walked through the door and he looked around and he literally said, I ain't seen this many black people in my whole life, and I ain't gonna let none tell me what to do. Of course, now I explained to him that, you know, it was not exactly optional. You know, you come in and you sit down and you behave, or I'll ask the sheriff to assist us. And he said, you can't sentence me. Well, I had to sentence him because he had committed a crime and he got 20 years in a day. He said, Judge, I can't do that. I can't do that. I said, well, just do the best you can. You know, you're going to jail and you're going today. So, and he said, what do you mean? Wait a minute. I said, look, you just go over there and you do the best you can. And before you know it, 20 years will have passed. But you got 20 years plus one day. And the reason for that is because we don't have truth in sentencing in Alabama. In Alabama, if you're sentenced to 20 years or less, you only have to serve one-third of your sentence. For example, life in Alabama turns out to be about 9 years that you spend in jail. But by adding a day, okay, that means he's beyond that 20-year mark. So he has to serve more than one-third of his sentence. So it took him a few months to figure that one out. But let me tell you, I got the nicest letter from him apologizing for his behavior and saying, "Judge, if you'd be so kind as to let me come back before you, I assure you my behavior will be different."
I think that happens to all of us.
It happens to all of us.
Does anyone have any questions? I don't want to take up all the questions. Yes.
Sorry, and I have a microphone, so I'll come around if you have a question.
Thank you. So are all the states that have partisan elections for judgeships in the South?
I don't know if all of them are in the South, but I can tell you that Alabama, Mississippi, and Arkansas, and Louisiana, and Texas are among those. Now, I'm not sure who the others are, but yes, the majority of them are in the South. Southern politics have been most yes. difficult to change.
Well, it's foreign to me. what can the judicial system do about that?
And let me say that the judicial system has attempted on more than one occasion to address that issue, but it has become a partisan issue. The parties, primarily the Democrats and the Republicans, the bulk of the money they earn is through filing fees. So if you're a Republican, the Republican Party will establish a filing fee for the job that you want, and you pay it to the party in Alabama. For example, I had to pay a fee of about $2,300 in order for the Democrats to put me on the ballot. And that's how the parties raise money. And as you know, folks don't want to give up their money. They have attempted, they being the judiciary, to influence the process. But each time the legislators have, well, one time they decided they would not give judges a raise and may even cut their salary, so that called for a really big fight. And judges by nature are not politically motivated, so we didn't have lobbyists and people to advise us as judges, but we had a weapon that sort of overcome almost all of that, because you see, legislators really like to get tickets, DUIs. They come to court too. Well, they changed their minds and decided that they would not cut the judges' salaries.
Everything's so political.
Yes, it is. Yes. Yes.
Oh, sorry. Judge, thank you for coming today. One of the judicial stories that I knew came out from Alabama is a specific judge down there refused to follow Supreme Court precedent with the recent same-sex marriage decision issued last year. And I was wondering if you think that that kind of behavior might stem from the fact that judges are subject to this political process in Alabama.
Yes, I think it influences. He's referring to Judge Roy Moore, who is the Chief Justice of the Alabama Supreme Court, re-elected. Judge Moore was our Chief Justice. He was removed from office for failure to follow a judicial order from the federal courts to remove the Ten Commandments from the judicial building. So he was removed by the court of the judiciary, and he returned because the people reelected him. And recently he refused to follow a mandate. Well, he advised probate courts that they did not have to issue marriage license to same-sex partners. And there have been some licensed directors in the state of Alabama that just stopped issuing marriage licenses rather than issue them to same-sex. My community is not, is issuing marriage licenses to anyone that show up and want a marriage license. And we talk about public policy. When I started practicing law, Alabama was probably the divorce mecca of the South because there was no waiting period for divorce. So we had lots of folks that come to Alabama to get a divorce. Well, we've since instituted a waiting period, so that has gone away. But now there's a waiting period to get married, except in Tennessee. So a lot of people from Alabama now go to Tennessee to get married. So that's how public policy can actually influence it.
I just wanted to say, and I don't mean to be disrespectful, but when you said that you didn't get a salary cut because the lawyers knew or had tickets, that makes it sound
No. What I didn't say, well, perhaps I didn't explain it quite adequately, and let me take another attempt at that. And it wasn't the lawyers, it was the legislators. And in Alabama legislature, both our House and our Senate, the majority of the people are non-lawyers. Now, I think they ought to be lawyers, because when you're making laws, you need somebody to understand the law. But they're elected by the people, and most of them are not lawyers. But I think that they rethought what they were doing, not because the judges actually said to them, you know, you need us, you may come before us. But when we look at the composition of the people that we, in Alabama, we don't send our best and our brightest necessarily to the state house. Okay. Someone did a study and more of them had bankruptcies, traffic tickets, DUIs, than you find in the general population. Now, let me say that my governor has said, now everybody's heard about my governor. He said just yesterday in North Alabama that he did not have sex with that woman.
Yeah, I got one right here. So last night, a KU student became the first black woman to ever compete in the finals of the national debate tournament. It's amazing.
Wonderful.
You guys can clap.
That's great.
Her and her partner did an amazing job. They didn't win. And so I thought, you know, that was a good way to get that into the conversation. But stemming from that, what were things that you guys did as young women that empowered you, that taught you things, and that, you know, built you to become the women that you are now?
You want to start?
Let me say that, to give you an example, neither my mother nor my father went to college. In fact, I finished high school 2 years before my mother, who went back and got her GED and went on to go into nursing because she had this great desire to help people. But they were both educationally motivated. My father absolutely believed that the road out of poverty was paved with education. That has proven to be true in the minority community, more so because, you know, when you look at the things that have gone wrong, health care, we have great health disparities within our community. We have educational disparities. You hear the statistics on unemployment. But education appears to be the thing that helps equalize what's going on. Now, that means I may have to have a JD where maybe all you need is a college degree, but in order to move up in the world. And it was never a question. As a juvenile court judge, I would get people to come and say, because truancy is a crime in Alabama. They said, Judge, I can't make him go to school. I go, he's in the eighth grade. What do you mean you can't make him go to school? He doesn't have an option. I never thought it was optional. I just knew you went to school every day because daddy said you went to school every day. I've never heard my daddy curse. I've never heard him curse at me. And he never took a belt, those other things to whip me. Now, mother, let me tell you, she was different. If they were aggressively pursuing child abuse, she'd have been coming up for parole. Daddy was just the opposite. You know, he would say, go to bed and we're gonna talk about it in the morning. Well, you'd be up all night, want to know, what are you gonna say in the morning? How are you gonna get out of this? But that was, he was mild-mannered, he never raised his voice, but he said, you will go to school, that's your job. I work at the Goodyear, I build tires, and it is a hard job, I don't want you to do it. So you're gonna get an education, so you don't have to do that. Now, because it's your job, you've got to do it well. You can't half-step, you're gonna go every day. And every day I went to school, I didn't think it was an option. That's not a prevailing attitude anymore. I'm telling you, I get parents that say, I couldn't make them go. You know, they go. Now, I also devised some systems. I have ordered some parents to go to school. You say your child leaves school after you drop them off? Well, you need to be there to see what they're doing. I gave one woman 16 days at school. And she went every day, and every day that she was there, her child was there. Now, after a while, he found out he kind of liked it. There were people that had been talked to, things were going on he hadn't missed out on. So I never, well, I think I did put one in jail, but I generally did not put parents in jail for the children not going to school. Instead, we came up with other remedies. But my motivation was my parents and my desire to move up in the world. I went to work for Sears and absolutely loved it, except they started midnight madness, opening on Sunday. Saturday, I had to miss all the football games. I said, I can't do this for the rest of my life. So that's what happened to me.
And I think there's not very much of a difference between those of us who are, I call them self-starters, who get out here and who have parents who, and I think I said this last week, who absolutely love you, even though they may make you go to work. Because parents really are very, very, very influential in the ways in which, and particularly, my parents are from the South too, so particularly Southern parents. I mean, they don't yell and scream. They just look at you strange. You say, uh-oh, something's getting ready to happen here. But it's also for, particularly for girls. I think my track was one that, I guess I said this last week, that my father started me on, and that is, okay, you know, go into politics. And for me, the head of the student council, I was the head of everything. I mean, I just said, this is what my father says, this is what they say do, and this is what I'm going to do. And you learn so much just being active in the school environment with people and your friends. And I think for me, that started me off because I was going to go to med school. And then I said, I don't think so. I think I like this better.
All right, so I deeply care about the separation of power and the independence of judiciary, so I'm gonna bring us back to the partisan nature of judges in Alabama. So what do you think, how does it change a judge's life or the kind of person who would end up running for a judge's position in a, you know, in a setup where you have to be partisan and you have to run for office at least. I mean, I don't even like that. When you have to become popular, you have to reach out to people because
yes, you do.
To be a judge, all you need is to be reasonable and you to have an understanding of the law.
You think?
And it's not just
really
being a
do
politician.
Do you really think that?
Right. I mean, being a politician is a completely different set of skills that you need.
Yes, it is.
Well, unless you're on the federal side, we don't run.
Right.
Right.
The federal
so
side.
How does,
but let
how
me
do
say
you think
let me say this about the federal side too.
Right.
It's not removed from politics.
No.
Because in order to be a federal district court judge, it's a presidential appointment. Now, in Alabama, well, take me for instance. Three times I applied, three times I came out number one on the list from our Democrat elected officials, number one from the state party, and generally the party that whose president is a member of control what happens. Except in Alabama, both of our senators are Republican and our president is a Democrat, and there is no meeting of the mind between the two. In order to become a federal district judge, you have to obtain what they call a blue slip. The blue slip is the approval from the senator in your state, and you have to get one from both of them, and they withhold it. And that's how they play politics. In Alabama, currently, we have six unfilled federal district court judgeships because the senators refuse to issue the blue slip so that anybody can get on the federal court. But yes, I agree with you. And for those very reasons that you have expounded, most states have gone away from the system of partisan elections for the judiciary because they recognize that the judiciary should be free of partisan influence. More importantly than the partisan influence is, in order to run for office, you have to raise money. Now let me give you a serious dichotomy here. Judges cannot ask people for money. A prohibition on it in Alabama, because if you ask somebody for money, you know, it may look like they're exerting influence over you. So you've got to run for office, you've got to run for a partisan election, you can't ask people for money, but you have to have money in order to run. But you've got to have radio, TV, and printed stuff, and look good, and all the other things that the other politicians do. So, you know, where's the balance? You must raise, and, you know, last time I ran for office, I had to raise almost $100,000 because it was a contested election. Except I can't ask people for money. You can't go in there and ask them, you can't send them a letter and ask them. You just gotta tell them you're running and hope they'll give your campaign out there some money. I remember the last time I was running, I had this brilliant idea that I know what I'll do. Well, actually my daughter had the idea, you know, it was not my thought, folks. She said, we're gonna set up a Facebook page for the campaign, and then we can send out information to everybody. I said, that's a wonderful idea. It won't cost any money. You know, you set up your Facebook pages. Lo and behold, Florida Supreme Court says all judges must deface immediately. Judges can't have random friends. But yes, I agree with you. Except it is what it is. And until you and I can work to get these things to change, more so you than I. And even in Alabama, there will be people that will speak out. It sometimes takes us a little bit longer in Alabama to make things change. But keep in mind, we're number one in the union.
Very much for being here. About 42 years ago, Clarence Kelly, who became the director of the FBI, first of all, confirmed director of the FBI since J. Edgar Hoover. He's chief of police of Kansas City, Missouri, and he entered into a relationship with the Police Foundation, which was, whose president at the time was Patrick Murphy. He was the chief of police in New York City. And Patrick had a relationship with James Q. Wilson, who was head of the law school, or criminal justice school at Harvard. And he died, I think, a couple years ago, a very famous man. And he created a team to evaluate a set of patrol experiments that Clarence Kelly put in place right before he became the director. And for 3 years, they contracted with the Federal Mediation and Conciliation Services to train citizens in high crime rate communities in Kansas City, 31st to 39th Street, Truce to Woodland, to train citizens in that community in the mediation principles. They also contracted with the American Arbitration Association to certify those same citizens to arbitrate disputes if they could not reach a consent agreement. James Q. Wilson evaluated those experiments, wrote it up in a book. The recidivism rates, the settlement rates were very, very high. The citizens in the community were incredible. Those citizens who mediated and arbitrated the disputes were paid. The grant money paid for it. After Clarence became the director of the FBI and after these reports were all written, this is 40 plus years ago, I had a conversation with Clarence Kelly, and he told me that the judiciary was not ready to embrace such a forward-thinking set of experiments. You're diverting criminal cases, turning them into civil cases where the rules of evidence are a little bit more favorable in a civil case than it is in a criminal case. You have lots of flexibility to mediate and arbitrate the disputes because it's being done in the community by people who live in the community, who understand those community values. Those consent agreements and those awards tend to stand up.
Agreed.
Why? Why today don't we do that?
And we do, and the judiciary is moving closer to it. When I introduced mediation into small claims court in my community, I was the only judge that did it for almost 3 years. When I started drug court in my community, they said, she's soft on crime. We're gonna have criminals running amok in the streets. And it has proven to be one of the best deterrents to crime. Because part of the crime is done because they own drugs. You get them off drugs and you treat them and keep them off drugs, then you don't have it. But you're absolutely correct. By the way, Clarence was in New York for a period of time, and he was part of that Rockefeller contingency. Many of you, well, you may not know this, but the war on drugs started with Rockefeller in New York, and it has led to where we are today with prison overcrowding, where we're warehousing whole segments of our population in prisons. We've got prisons in Alabama that are at 200 and 300% of capacity. It's that way all over the nation. Many of these people are there for possession of marijuana. Okay. So yes, it happens, but I agree with you. I am a proponent, and in fact, the next leg of my career is gonna be in mediation. Absolutely believe in it. And also, let me say this, if I could do what I really, really wanted to do, I believe the skills that you use in mediation are transferable or can be taught to others. We're raising a whole generation of little violent people. I think we could go into the schools and teach those same skill sets where we could teach our children to resolve their disputes without resorting to violence, and hence we would make this a safer world for everybody. Why do I think the school should be the place to do it? Because we're not doing it in the home. We all know that yes, it should come from the home, but it's not happening there. So the school is the next line of defense for our children, and I think it can be taught. I think it can be taught so that, and I'm not talking about peer mediation, I'm talking about teaching our young people the same skills we give them in mediation. You see, when I do a mediation, I don't tell either side what to do. But instead, my whole role is to guide them so that they can fashion their own remedy. Yes, I may have to ask them, can I tell the other side this, or do we need to know this? But that's part of the mediation process. So I think it can be taught to a larger segment of the population, and we can teach so that we won't have so much violence.
You don't have a mediation program in your federal courts?
Yes, federal courts.
It's mandatory.
Everywhere it's mandatory in federal courts. Mm-hmm. But of course, it's like anything else. If the judges don't embrace it and talk about it and actually refer cases to it, it don't happen.
Well, Clarence did, in part, was he put a person at the warrant desk of municipal court. Mm-hmm. People could go to the warrant desk and they could accept mediation and arbitration
right then and
as an alternative. Mm-hmm. He also had police officers who would be in the home on domestic disturbances. It's been so long since I've been involved in this, 40 plus years, but in the South Patrol experiments done in Kansas City, a police officer had been in the home of a domestic dispute that led to very serious violence three or more times in an 18-month period. 62% of the time, an officer had been in that home at least three times. So what he did was he had the officers empowered to offer mediation and arbitration in lieu of arrest, because he felt that if you took one of the parties out, I mean, if you arrested someone, it escalated the intensity of the conflict. But by working with the couples and offering mediation and arbitration in lieu of arrest, he felt that that created a climate for better resolution. So.
And let me say, I think the skills that I picked up in mediation training, and by the way, I went to mediation training so long ago, it was free. State of Alabama don't give you anything free, but I went through it in 2006 and it was free. Now you have to pay for it. Back then it was free because they were trying to get people to go and to learn the skills and to know more about it. So now you really have to pay. Mm.
What is the toughest lesson that you have had to learn, personally or otherwise?
Life is always learning something. So
right. Some people have to learn humility, other mm-hmm. people have to learn what just keeps coming
Let
up.
Let me say this, when you run for public office, there are certain skill sets. One is you gotta have a strong constitution, because people in the public will say anything to you. Not only that, they would give $25 to your campaign, and they said, well, look, I gave you money to your campaign, so why are you upset that I'm calling you at midnight? So you've got to learn to be tough. In the courtroom, I control the courtroom setting, and I have to control it in a manner that it will not be disruptive. And plus, you don't want to get on the news for doing crazy things. We know a lot of judges do crazy things, and you don't want to infringe on the rights of other citizenry. So you've got to learn to control that environment, not with an iron fist, but with a degree of sincerity and with a degree that there's no deviation. You know, in my courtroom, I am the authority. And you need to understand that. So there are certain things that will happen. And it doesn't take long for the general public to get it. I'm in a pretty tight community like you have here. For example, I decided that if I could see your rear end that was obscene. So do fellas come in with the pants hanging in my courtroom? No. If they're in handcuffs, they're holding those pants up because there's a certain amount of respect for the court and the community that you must demonstrate. Young ladies, when they come into the courtroom, if I can see that you do not have on underwear, it's a problem
for you, because I'm going to hold you in contempt of court. So you're going to show a certain amount of respect, not just for the court, but for the community. Court is generally open to the public, so the public is coming. And people come, they come and just sit down and watch and see what's going on. So, you know, you've got to be, you know, if I can see through it and y'all don't have the best sight, you got a problem. And community norms are generally what influences what goes on. And I've seen things change over the generations. You know, at one point, everybody wears these pajama pants now in Huntsville, Alabama.
What are those?
The little pants that you used to sleep in them. Now they wear them everywhere. Now you wear them everywhere.
Pajama pants.
You guys know what I'm talking about, don't you? See, all of
you do? Is this a break group? I never heard of pajama pants.
You?
You've heard of them? All right.
I was working with Cody. Cody knows. So you know, community norms control what you're going to do. In some more metropolitan areas, you will probably be able to get away with some things that you could not get away with. I'm carrying a group of high school students. I volunteer one day a week at Columbia High School, which is our international baccalaureate school. And I'm going to take 6 students from Columbia High School in Huntsville, Alabama, to New York City. And we're going to compete in the global school program, and we're going to visit the United Nations headquarters. So I said to them and their parents, you know, I want you to have a professional appearance when we go to New York and during your competition and during our visit to the United Nations headquarters. And one little girl raised her hand and she said, and I said, yes. She said, can I wear my flip-flops? No, oh, you can't wear your flip-flops.
If there aren't any other questions, we will go ahead and finish up for today. But I do want to thank both of the two judges for coming here today. I think it was a really great program.
Thank you.
And if you have any further questions, you want to ask them something at the end of the program, you're definitely welcome to. Remember that next week we will have another program with our next guest next week, and so that will be at 4 o'clock again next Tuesday. We'll have brownies, we'll have cookies, and we hope you join us for that discussion.
Thank you.